Okay. Okay.
Μπορούμε να αρχίσουμε.
Ωραία.
I will start, Theodosi, because of the banner. I was indicated as the coordinator, but I am not coordinator. Your Eminences, dear fathers, beloved students of our postgraduate master program in Orthodox Ecumenical Theology. This is the first open public lecture offered by this program, with the main speaker being the Vice President of CEMES, of our Center of Ecumenical, Missiological and Environmental Studies. I wish all our listeners happy and a blessed year, new year. And for those who have just started celebrating Christmas, those following the old calendar, Merry Christmas too. This is the first, as I said, section, the first open public lecture, which was scheduled to be coordinated by Professor Christian Sonea, but he asked me, because of some other obligations, to replace him. And I assigned this coordination to Dr. Theodosios Kyriakidis. And I will be just one of the debaters. Dr. Kyriakidis, the floor is yours now to introduce the main speaker.
Thank you, Professor Vasiliadis. I would like to welcome all of our listeners to this open public lecture given by Professor Dimitrios Keramidas, titled Historical Factors of the Estrangement Between the Catholic and the Orthodox Church. Let me give some a short biographical data of our speaker today. Professor Dimitrios Keramidas was born in Thessaloniki. He studied ecumenical theology at the Theological School of the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, and missiology at the Faculty of Missiology of the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. He teaches ecumenism and Orthodox theology at the Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas, known as Angelicum of Rome. He also collaborates with other universities in Italy and Greece. His research fields include Orthodox contemporary theology, Orthodox Catholic dialogue, theology of mission and interfaith dialogue. He is co-chair of the Ecumenical Dialogue Group of the International Orthodox Theological Association, vice president of CEMES, our center of Ecumenical, Missiological and Environmental Studies, Metropolitan Panteleimon Papagiorgiou, based here in Thessaloniki, and partner of the Italian Association of Ecumenists. With no further delay, I will give the floor to Professor Dimitrios Keramidas, in order to start with his lecture, and then we will have the time and the opportunity to discuss on his lecture. Please, Professor Keramidas, you have the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you, Theodosios. Good afternoon to all.
and greetings for a happy and fruitful new year. And I'm very, very happy to be able to take part in this set of lectures on the relations between the Catholic and the Orthodox Church, which had already been a topic that has been already been addressed in previous lectures organized by the center. So I'm not myself a historian, so I will try to give kind of theological understanding of history. It is not my ambition to replace historians in this task. And I will somehow continue what has been presented in the first of this set of lectures by Father Yasaf Destivel, who introduced the topic and also reminded that the term estrangement was introduced by Yves Congar in what concerns a theological encounter between the Catholic and the Orthodox Church, a dialogue between East and West. So this term says in a very few words that what concerns the so-called schism or break of Eucharistic sacramental communion between Rome and Constantinople did not happen in a specific date, but concerned everything: politics, culture, language, different languages, different vocabularies, different theologies that were shaped in the East and the West that led to this gradual separation. We conventionally designed the year 1054 as the break of communion between the churches, but historians have shown that this was not the beginning of the so-called schism, if there was a schism at that time between the two churches, between Rome and Constantinople. So we have to understand the relations in a wider context that concerned, as I said before, going back to Yves Congar, everything that had to do with the churches at that time. So actually I found very interesting a definition given to schism by the well-known historian Stephen Rassiman, who said that a schism is the emergence of a separate faction within the church. So if we have separate factions within the church, in other words, if we have separate realities within the one church, then yes, we can say that there is a schism within the church. This, of course, concerns not only the relations between Orthodox and Catholics, but also among the different Eastern Christian families. When we have two altars in the same territory, yes, there is in strict terms a schism, even though today we speak more of break of communion between the Catholics and the Orthodox rather than of schism. Yet parallel structures were created in the East and later in the West by both churches. As also John Megendorf notes in his work, Byzantine Theology, and I quote, "The schism which separated the Greeks and the Latins could not be identified with any particular event or even be dated precisely. Political opposition between Byzantium and the Frankish Empire, a gradual estrangement in thought and practice," and here Mayendorf receives completely the idea that the schism did not happen at a specific date. So a gradual estrangement in thought and practice, diverged developments in both theology and ecclesiology played their respective parts in this process of estrangement. But in spite of the historical factors, Mayendorf continues, which pushed the two halves of Christendom further and further apart, there were political forces working in favor of union. The Byzantine emperors, for example, systematically tried from the 13th to the 15th centuries to re-establish ecclesiastical communion with Rome, and thus gain Western support against the Turks. In fact, neither the schism nor the failure of the attempts at reunion can be explained exclusively by socio-political or cultural factors. The difficulties created by history, he continues, could be resolved if there had been a common ecclesiological criterion to settle the theological, canonical, or liturgical issues, keeping the East and the West apart. Now, what Megatov is saying here is that, yes, there have been political, socio-political, cultural factors that led to the estrangement, to the separation, to the lack of communion between the two churches, but one should not underestimate the pressure, the influence that theological, liturgical, and ecclesiological elements had for that separation. And of course, one could argue in favor of this idea that both Byzantine and Frankish Empire do not exist anymore. So we can immediately proceed to the reestablishment of communion. Yet the communion between the churches is still to be established. So we can see also behind the historical or historical-political factors, the presence and the persistence of some precise theological, ecclesiological reasons. This is to affirm that, yes, there has been an estrangement between the two churches, where also the theological factors and the ecclesiological reasons played their own important role. Ranciman says that initially the different understandings on theological factors concerned only church leaders or churchmen in general, monks and so on, or even emperors. What brought down to the popular level these different ideas were the Crusades. So it was the 12th and 13th century that the schism became a reality that the people of the church live in their flesh, a reality of division, not a formal act of separation, but different understanding of theology, of ecclesiology, of some liturgical customs, and so on. So the two people did not understand each other as brothers and sisters anymore. So for the future, we could say, based on that the reestablishment of full communion, of unity between the churches, will not be the outcome of a formal decree of union, as has been the attempt some centuries ago, but it will be the visible, final, and solemn sign of this living together. So if estrangement is living separately, the union will be the result, the outcome of this living together. So we have, of course, as theologians, both as theologians and historians, the task to understand and analyze the historical reasons that led to this separation. Theology and church is not always separated from history, but history is not separated in its turn from theology, culture, and religious beliefs. Megendorf, again, in his book Constantinople and Moscow, Historical and Theological Studies, I think this I can say this this with you. makes this outline that the two centers, Rome and Constantinople, with different church structures, the idea of apostolicity in Rome and the imperial structures on which church organization was based in the East. And on the basis of that, we had different ecclesiological developments regarding, for instance, papal authority in the synodical system or even authority in the church. Later, we had different, as he explains, theological models or methods of thought. In the East, we had this theology based on hesychasm, or this mystical monastic experience of communion with God, whereas in the West, especially in the 13th century, we had this contrast with the scholar university, with the universities, and of course, the scholastic theology. So this estrangement was translated also as a different theological methods. So it was not only the essence of the debates, but also the way in which each church explained her faith in different methods. So it was impossible at that time for Greeks and Latins in the 13th or even in the 14th century to understand each other, not only because they spoke different languages, but also because they used different theological languages, different theological vocabularies and methods. So he, Megendorf, sums up the main ideas. So in this outline, one could of course see the issue of filioque, which was among the reasons of separation back in the 11th century, which already existed even at the local level in the West. Had been pronounced by some local councils in Spain back in the 7th century. It was not accepted by Rome, and it was not until the 9th century a question of debate, of doctrinal debate between the two churches. And filioque, in its turn, was a way to express the faith using a vocabulary that could defend some theological principles. The Latins always said that the filioque was introduced in order to underline, to secure the divinity of Christ. The Byzantines rightly argued that no addition to the creed can be made beyond the conciliar context by a person alone, by the Pope or by a local church alone. So we have all this set of themes that were part of this estrangement, and of course there were other of minor importance, like the different liturgical customs, the use of leavened or unleavened bread in the two churches, the purgatory, the idea of purgatory, and others. So this estrangement was one. Recognizing this estrangement, the pressure of political factors, different historical circumstances, the use of different languages, the use of different customs based on the Greek philosophy in the East or the Roman Latin law in the West, which later were translated in a new set of differences, such as the hesychasm, the mystical theology in the East, scholastic theology in the West. So Megendorf says that cultural and historical differences may easily lead to theological divergences, but such divergences need not become contradictions and incompatibilities. So the real question is, given that that estrangement make impossible at that time, the 13th or 14th century, the union between the two churches, can these different languages, different theologies or different theological methods, these diversities be reconsidered in a way that they will not create in the future hindrance to unity? So it is a question of course, of theological study, of analysis, but also of ecumenical method. Who follows the contemporary Orthodox Catholic dialogue, and especially the official documents issued by the Joint International Commission, realize that these documents from the 80s, at the last one of Katie 2016, have a theological content. So the criterion or the methodology accepted and used by the commission was not to make a historical analysis on the causes of the division, but to reaffirm some basic theological or ecclesiological principles. Now, the 80s, we had documents concerning the Trinitarian dimension of the church, the sacramental nature of the church as image of the Trinity, faith, apostolic succession, or ordained ministries, and so on. In the last two documents, focused on the issues of authority in the church and the local, regional, universal level, as well as on primacy and synodality. All these are theological, ecclesiological issues, because the commission has not the mandate to make a historical, systematic, scientific analysis of all these elements, but to make some theological affirmations that can be also a way to overcome differences and create a path towards unity. It is a methodology that was supported also by major Orthodox theologians such as the Metropolitan of Pergamon, John Zizulis, among the architects of the official theological Orthodox Catholic dialogue. Yet other groups which promote this theological dialogue, such as the San Irenaeus joint Orthodox Catholic working group, have produced other interesting documents, choosing another hermeneutical principle. That is the role of history in the consideration of the relation between the churches. I will not present here the document which I had the chance to do in some months ago in Rome. But what is important for me is the historical outline, the observations that this document makes regarding the two churches. So it divides the historical part of the documents, divides the history in some major periods. It is the early church period and the period of estrangement, the one that interests us, which goes from the 9th to the 15th century. And then the period of the confessionalization, the period of ecclesiological introversion, and the period of ecclesiological renaissance. So the idea here is not to repeat the work that the official commission of the dialogue does, but to support its work through another hermeneutical approach, that is making historical observations and underlying the importance of historical factors. So the period of estrangement goes from the 9th to the 15th centuries, the most critical ones in what concerns, strictly speaking, the break between the two churches. Again, here, the document does not speak explicitly of 1054, but it enlarges its approach from the 9th to the 15th centuries. That is actually the Council of Florence and the fall of Constantinople. The general principle of the working group is the following one. It is the statement that the group makes under number 5. And I quote, "The reasons for the separation of our churches were not only theological, but also had political, social, cultural, psychological, and other dimensions. Indeed, political and cultural factors strongly influenced the development of ecclesiastical structures in East and West. Therefore, in examining the causes and consequences of schisms, the role of these actors must be considered and assessed theologically. More particularly, this requires a multidisciplinary approach that also takes into account these aspects that have little dogmatic relevance, but nevertheless affect the ecclesiological practice of the of the churches. Such factors still contribute to the difficulties in the official theological dialogue between our churches. So the idea here is, again, the role of history, the role of extra theological factors, and how these factors should be considered theologically, to the extent that they still contribute, as the group says, to the difficulties in the official theological dialogue. So again, it is a useful document that has to be read carefully by all those against in the dialogue. I think a Greek translation of the document is underway now. How these elements are understood theologically. The history of the church is not simply a history of division. We can find many divisions in church history, in the East, in the West, between East and West, but also histories of stories of reunion. Even in the critical period of Enstrangement, 9th, 15th centuries, according to the document, there were some attempts to reunion. The Council of Lyon, later on the Council of Florence, and so on. As I said before, it was perhaps impossible at that time for the churches, for the people who were involved in these dialogues, to make a creative synthesis between the two theological methods. Those who dared such kind of synthesis were rejected by the Orthodox. Some of them became Catholics. So other attempts of dialogue between West and East were the translations of the works of some Thomas Aquinas into Greek by Greeks, Greek intellectuals, and these translations, according to modern theologians, were the evidences of the alienation of Orthodoxy from its roots. I could quote here Christos Yannaras, who in his book Orthodoxy and the West considers the translation of Aquinas into Greek as the fall of Constantinople, and not the fall of that took place in 1453. So we have, in this case, the case of Yannaras, a reading of historical factor in which he gives a theological explanation which goes beyond a legitimate difference. For him, introducing Aquinas roots, I think this approach can be appreciated, but it does not help to the understanding of history in a positive way. Now, what has changed since then? Because it would be an anachronism to go back and reconstruct an ideally unified church that perhaps never existed in the way that we imagine. And as Metropolitan Euler says, it is unrealistic to cancel the second millennium and go back to the first millennium and to the exact conditions of the first millennium. The task is to read critically history, but in a new manner, not in a manner that confirms our vision of the others that have been separated from us, but to understand the differences as legitimate differences to the extent that they express the faith in a different way. So, and this is, at least in my humble opinion, the main task of the Orthodox today, because we do not have at least sufficiently developed a theology of differences. We speak of in our ecumenical encounters, We speak of the unity in faith, unity in sacraments. We speak of the fathers of the church, unity in the apostolic faith, unity in the teaching of the ecumenical councils. We accept all means of collaboration at the social level, at the pastoral level, but we do not have developed yet a theology of differences. So Congar tried to describe the history of the church as a history of diversities, which are part of church life. So the Orthodox until now have not expressed this task in a clear way, at least to my understanding. So what do we mean by unity? Is it uniformity? Do we have uniformity in the church? Is uniformity a means to unity? We can't accept some differences as means of unity. So in this way, the history of estrangement today is we have the history of rapprochement can help us to bring back on the ground our dogmatic differences. So we had always diversities in the church, in the celebration of Easter, for instance, which is an issue as old as the church herself, or the use of the so-called ecclesiastical economy in the East, the dispensatio in the West, the different liturgical rites in the East, which existed also in the West, or the minor liturgical differences that did not disturb or touch the essence of the sacraments, or the different creeds used in the East and West, the so-called Apostolic Creed in the West, and the Nicene Constantinopolitan Creed in the East, for baptismal reasons. So the history of the church is a history of difference. To what extent do we Orthodox accept differences in our life? And also from a missionary point of view, the history of the Byzantine church is a history of difference. We always defended the principle of diversity when Cyril and Methodius evangelized the Slavs. They defended that principle that each people should celebrate and glorify the Lord in his own language against other ideas coming from the German or Latin clergy, who supported that only in Latin the liturgy should be celebrated. So we have in our history this principle of differences, of diversity, of legitimate diversity. Now, it is in principle also confirmed synodically, and one can immediately recall in this regard the Council of Constantinople of 879 and 880, which confirmed Photius' election at the throne of Constantinople, but brought reconciliation among Rome and Constantinople, reaffirming that each church in its own context could continue to celebrate or use its own liturgical customs. So this principle has also been confirmed synodically. We should apply that today. And this is one of the reasons that many Orthodox have supported the idea that the Council of 889 could be recognized by both Orthodox and Catholics as an ecumenical council. For the principle that it introduced, the principle of reconciliation, the principle of unity in the context of legitimate diversities. And to that extent, I think that in that sense, I think that the history can help a lot theology to understand the development of theological differences. Now, as I'm close to my conclusions, what is the main issue today in the Orthodox Catholic dialogue, and to some good extent among the Orthodox, is in which way interchurch relations are realized. So if and to what extent and by whom authority is exercised in the church, and what is the order of communion among the churches. This is the issue that has been studied by the official Orthodox Catholic dialogue in the last two documents of Ravenna 2007 and Katie 2016. The issue of authority, the issue of primacy, the issue of synodality at the local, regional, and universal level. So again, here we can choose or to remain in our so-called micro-narratives. So each church understands her own practices, her own understanding of canon law, of theology, of authority in an exclusivistic way. Or we could proceed to a synthesis of these micro narratives, a positive synthesis of these micro narratives, and apply this principle not in terms of confessional apology, but in terms of a positive attitude towards the other. An example of that is, of course, the already mentioned Council of 879. It is, of course, the Apostolic Canon 34 that has always offered a canonical support to the Orthodox to argue in favor of this creative and synergic interrelation between the many, the first and the many, at all levels and dimensions of church life. It is the very idea of the Pentarchy, which of course does not exist anymore, but the idea of the Pentarchy within the Byzantine context, of course, was that in the one Christian oikumene, in the Christian world, these regional churches, these regional patriarchates, and Rome was one of the five patriarchates, were able to achieve interdependence with each other in a synodical way, respecting the orders that had been given to some sees, Rome, Constantinople in the east and in the east and the west, while maintaining each its own practices and customs. So this is an idea that already existed some 100 years ago in the Byzantine that could perhaps be a model of unity in the future. This interaction between churches and this interaction which does not alter internal practices to the extent, of course, that these practices agree with apostolic tradition and ecumenical councils. Now, in that sense, one could also see critically the idea proposed in the 20th century by some Orthodox theologians, Russians and Greeks as well, that every Western influence in Greek theology was a negative element that needs to be eliminated. The idea is the famous one of pseudomorphosis addressed by George Florovsky. so we could not anymore, if we desire unity, understand this encounter, this interaction between East and West, or nowadays between North and South, this exchange of ideas, of principle, as pseudomorphosis, as alienation of from our own roots. But it is a dynamic way of coexistence without the risk of losing what is the essence of our faith. So we could go beyond that model, which has perhaps some good intentions, but cannot be applied anymore, at least to my opinion, in the ecumenical encounters. Finally, and I will close with that. It is the question of universality. In the past, as we know, and this is explained by many historians and in the official dialogue, and especially in the document of San Irenaeus group of which I spoke before, the universality has been a claim of papacy. And in a different way, it has been also a Byzantine claim, even though it was addressed in different ways, perhaps more synodically in the East, in a more centralized manner in the West. Nowadays, no church can claim this kind of exclusive universality. If we have a society that interacts, a globalized society that interacts, this must be also the case for the churches. So this exchange of theologies, exchange of experiences, exchange of spiritualities that, I repeat, has already been affirmed in the ancient canonical tradition could be also the way of a reconciled way to see the coexistence of the Christians in the future. So universality, of course, belongs to the essence of the Christian message, to the Christian gospel. But no church can claim anymore for herself an exclusive universality. Universality means that we encounter with each other, we meet with each other. It is close to the Orthodox idea of synodality, that is the regional meeting of the meeting of many regional churches, of course, under the leadership, under the guidance of person, authority, a bishop that presides over this meeting, this synodical meeting, in the context of a communio ecclesiology. So, and I close with that. The estrangement allows us to see the relations between East and West in a wider way. Not only dogma, not everything is dogma, but we have different theologies, which in their turn were shaped often under the influence of cultural, linguistic, political factors. So not any difference is illegitimate. We have many legitimate diversities that have to be discovered. So it is a work of discernment that needs to be, that we have to undertake. And this work must be done in a synergic, synodical way in order to promote inter-church, inter-Christian reconciliation. Otherwise, I'm afraid we will perpetuate our differences, we perpetuate each one its own universalism, micro-universalism, with painful results for the whole Christian body. So I will end my presentation here, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Dimitrios Keramidas, for this rich in ideas lecture. And as Dimitrios Keramidas said, this the issue of the estrangement of the two churches is complex. It touches on theological, historical, cultural, social, psychological dimensions, and this was a gradual process. Keramidas didn't speak only about estrangements. As he said, the history of the church is a history of differences, of diversity. We have between the church diversity, and of course we have also history of efforts of reunion. And he mentioned some examples. So I think now we can proceed with discussion. And first of all, I would like Professor Vasiliadis to make a comment, and then we can continue with the rest of our audience and the contributors to this event today. Professor Vasiliadis, please, you have the floor.
On my part, I also express my gratitude to my colleague Dimitrios Keramidas. I would like to remind all our listeners that his lecture was deliberately placed after the initial two Greek and two English speaking presentations, insisting on the, as the title of his lecture was, on the historical factors of the estrangement between Rome and Constantinople. And since we are not Holy Synod or a committee, ecclesiastical committee to solve this problem, but scholars who analyze the reasons of this estrangement, and we want to present to our church leaders and to the faithful of both East and West, both Oriental and Eastern Orthodox and Latin and Greek Catholic churches, the result of our concern for, as the title of the whole series is, the unity of the Church of Christ. I insist that we are desperate in going back, as Professor Meyendorf, according to the presentation of Professor Keramidas, made this clear. The historical dimension is very important. That's why today's main debaters are historians. Professor Stamatopoulos is a historian per se, but with interest and concern about the ecclesiastical life. And also the coordinator today is also a historian, and historian by profession, but at the same time a theologian. We'll try to see how these historical factors, in addition to theologicals, because also we are theologians, and among those who will continue this debate are also theologians, but also historians, looking back into the first millennium, when this estrangement, according to the presentation made by Professor Keramidas, this period of the so much caused by theological disputes, the theological disputes came later in order to give a theological validation to what has happened because of other, mostly historical, political, social, and so on, sectors. And this is important because we realized that, and we will have also Professor Moskos another historical presentation to see how this division or estrangement started, and this started from between, let's say, Rome and Constantinople, and later it was exacerbated in the so-called Slavic area for other reasons. I will say in my later in the discussion, explain what I mean by this. And this has almost made more difficult any approach. We are experiencing this very day the difficult, not only because of the latest development in the difficulties in the jurisdictions and how one can intervene to other ecclesiastical territories or jurisdictions for the Russian Exarchy in Africa, but also because of the so-called dispute of the Ukrainian autocephaly. But even previously, the difficulties the Orthodox faced in, before and after the Holy and Great Council have shown to us at least that there are other more important issues that need to be solved first before we come to the desired union between East and West. This is my short intervention at the beginning, just to justify and the importance of the historians, and that's why we invited historians at this first lecture of the year, of the new year, and we will have this kind of interaction of theology and history and other sociology and other elements and approaches to see how we can understand, in order to division, existing division, the sacramental division, the lack of communion between Rome and Constantinople. Dr. Kyriakidis, the floor is with the others to yes. Discuss this issue.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments, Professor Vasiliadis. And speaking of historians, I think now is the time to give the floor to Dimitris Stamatopoulos, Professor Dimitris Stamatopoulos from the University of Macedonia, in order to place to make his comment.
Thanks, Theodosios. Thank you very much, Dimitris, for this thorough presentation. Of course, as historian, I'm hesitated for this kind of theology of reconciliation, because the future is always open for new mistakes and new wrong decisions for both parts, or for three parts, Moscow included. I mean that, of course, we know, all of us, that history cannot teach us for anything. But if we could see back to the past of this process of estrangement, you described very, very well, I will notice first that the middle of the 11th century was exactly a moment, of course, the schism began in the 18th century, no doubt for that. And it began through the competition of around the problem of conquer, the cultural conquer of Slav world. We know that Cyril and Methodios was exactly the response of Byzantium against the rise of the new Roman Empire of Charlemagne in West. But the 11th century was exactly the moment of a culmination of power of both churches. 20 years ago, after 1854, the Pope won the battle of investiture controversy against the German Emperor, and the Byzantine Patriarch also was empowered through exactly the decline of the state. We know that the decline of the state after the first fall of Constantinople till the second created the appropriate conditions for the empowerment of the church in the late Byzantine period. And these new jurisdictions of Byzantine church survived inside the Ottoman power system, Ottoman administration system. The Sultan recognized the institution. So it was very interesting that we have this kind of, how can I say, a momentous moment, exactly when the churches felt very strong, stronger than the states that have to confront. But I think here maybe Yanaras was right to notice that after the two falls of Istanbul, of Constantinople, we have an imbalance between the two churches. We have the Orthodox Church under a non-Christian ruler, and this changed the things of survival in the Ottoman Empire. However, Yanaras, I think, promoted a kind of theology of inferiority, of a complex of inferiority. The truth is that the Orthodox Church very often collaborated with the Ottoman power exactly to limit or to resist to the extension of the Western powers, and the papal, of course, state was a pioneer to these coalitions against the Ottoman Empire. However, I will notice here something which usually we avoided to see it. It's a kind of assimilation, of one church to the other, and I mean of the Orthodox Church to the Catholic Church. For example, during the 16th century, we have a very important personality in the Patriarchate of Constantinople, Jeremiah the Great. Jeremiah, I think, has four or five terms, recognized the Patriarchate of Moscow. He established also the College of Saint Athanasius in Rome. That means Jeremiah recognized this kind of political inferiority of Constantinople against Moscow and Rome, but at the same time, and I think at the exactly during the Trento Council in northern Italy, Jeremiah and his committee of theologians rejected, exactly as Catholic Church did, the doctrines of Protestant churches. And the rejection, this rejection was, I think, very important moment of 16th century, because the Orthodox Church understood the real danger. The real danger from Protestants was exactly to doubt the intermediated role between the God and the faithful, between the ruler and the subjects. And the Orthodox Church followed exactly the solutions the Catholic Church gave in Trento. And this, I think, was very important, because this model of papal concentration system was very attractive. The Orthodox Church was attracted by this kind of concentration system of popes in next centuries. Although, of course, they have to confront the danger of Catholic missionaries. On one hand, they had to limit the influence of the Catholic Church in the territories of the Ottoman Empire, and on the other hand, they were attracted by the ways of Pope impose his power, his jurisdictions in his world. Of course, 17th century with Cyril Lucaris was something else. It was a revival of the big discussion of the content of what Greek means as concept, and a new kind of reconceptualization and contextualization of the old terms, of the medieval terms. But Saint Irenaeus, I think you showed us his diagram, his book's contents, was right also to describe the new era, the 20th century, as a kind of ecclesiastical revival, if I remember well. Yes, because the Orthodox churches of the old Ottoman Empire, now they had been nationalized, of course, but under Christian rulers. And this is very important to feel equal, to feel ready exactly for a new dialogue, for a new rapprochement, as you described very well. Of course, now the Orthodox world has been fragmentized, dispersed in many Orthodox churches all around the Eastern and Southeastern Europe. And of course, with the big brother of Russia to attend this game. But I think this is very important. 19th century brought a very important moment, the schism of old Catholics. Exactly when the Pope claimed for his priority in all church, one part of the Catholic world was, how can I say, resisted to this claim, and Orthodox churches found, how can I say, a brother, a secret brother inside the barracks of the great opponent. And the 20th century brought another great moment, the theology of liberation. Here we found brothers in other continents, not in Europe. So I think it is truth that now maybe we have the real conditions for a dialogue from between equals and not under this kind of, can I say, inferiority, imbalance condition of the long Ottoman period, the long Turkokratia, as usually said here in Greece. This is my remark, and maybe will be useful for the rest of the discussion.
Thank you, Professor Stamatopoulos. I think your thoughts will enrich our discussion. Before, I'm not sure if we have questions on YouTube or on chat. I don't see anything. So I think before we continue, I can I would ask Professor Dimitrios Moskos, whom I see here at our Zoom meeting, if he has a remark before we continue. Professor Dimitrios Moskos from the University of Athens, who is of course theologian and professor of history, church history. So I think it's a good opportunity to hear also his thoughts on our subject. Professor Moskos, please, if you are willing to give us your thoughts.
Thank you. Thank you, Prof. Kyriakidis, and thank you, Dr. Keramidas, for this very valuable insight in this topic. And I followed that. I heard everything in the YouTube, but I recently got in the Zoom link. So I heard everything, and I enjoyed also the contribution of Dimitri Stamatopoulos, of Professor Stamatopoulos. I think also I agree also that we to have to work very, very hard through the understanding of the historical narrative of the two traditions from the East and the West in order to produce a very solid base for understanding what has actually happened in this course of these 10 centuries of the second millennium. I have to confess that I also tried myself to initiate something. I proposed also, it was one of the encounters in the Theological Faculty of Athens during Erasmus lectures the previous years. Someday 2017 we had a guest from Rostock, where I also teach, and was Professor Holtze, who presented us a booklet at the anniversary of the 500 years after Reformation. There was a common booklet from a joint committee between Orthodox and between Catholics and Protestants about the history of Reformation. And I found it very interesting that Catholics and Protestants actually did achieve to produce a common narrative, a common concept of what has happened in the Reformation. So I think it would be also very important for us, and I said that, and it was a very good moment, because Father Theodoros Kondidis was there at the faculty, and he became now Archbishop of Athens for the Catholics. So I proposed also that would be nice for us, very, very important, actually, not only nice, but pivotal for our relations, to produce something similar for very important, challenging historical moments, like, for example, the Fourth Crusade or something. So it would be important to prepare something in common in order to understand and grasp these tense historical situations. So I think this idea to create a joint working group or something, working on these things, I said it once again a couple of years before discussing about the Council of Florence at the Institute of Jesuits here in Athens. I think we could move some way further and call also to join specialized professors of history like Dimitris Stamatopoulos and other people to work on this collectively and work on specific issues, not generally, but you know to tear down, so to say, actual historical moments. That would be very, very useful, I think. So that is my overall comment. And I would like also to add to something that Dimitris Stamatopoulos said about the 20th century. Of course, 20th century is very important. I would say it's not primarily the idea that the local churches have become a national Christian states of their own. This is important, but it's under the auspices of national romanticism, where all these things still work under a substitute of medieval symbols. I think the actual turn for the relations between the Catholics and the Orthodox was the interwar period. I mean, the time after the First World War, where all these mechanisms, this universe of Christian medieval symbols and remnants of the European political sky, like Kaisers and Tsars and Sultans, and all these things collapsed very abruptly. So the Christians realized that they are actually naked under these modern political constellation of their times. So they started to think that they have to build another sort of understanding of the global course of Christianity in a more differentiated way. So that was, for me, the most important motive and for this rapprochement, which is very important, and we have to work on this this momentum that began after that, and then there are more challenges of that kind in the 21st century, such as the global survival after all these common problems in environment and security and all these things. So it is important to promote these differentiated pictures, not intermediated through medieval symbolic tools. Although, of course, there are parts of the Orthodox Church, and not only the Orthodox Church, that work, still try to work with these tools, like, you know, Moscow and all these Slavic, not Slavic, but I think more Putin way fabricated universe that works on these, that translates all these things in a sort of medieval glossary in order to reassert itself in this situation. So it's a very it's a complicated constellation from that point of view. Yes, well, that's the first comment. We can discuss about these things. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Moskos. I'm not sure if we have any question. I would like to add in the discussion three elements. First of all, we have to keep in mind that the terms are changing. The terms we use are changing during the time. For example, the term Latin. In the past, the Byzantine understood the term as those they identify with this term, people of the West, regardless of their ethnicity or political affiliation, and with no negative connotation attached to it. The term Latin in the term Latin, a negative connotation was added, of course, since the 11th century, but especially after the 1204, with the fall of Constantinople by the Franks. And of course, after that, the main split, let's say, which was felt also on people, and not only on theologians, was happened. And leads me to the second comment, which is we have to keep in mind also the role of the flock, the people, and the propaganda that several, let's say, charismatic figures, spiritual figures, can have and influence the flock. And I have in mind saying that Avxentios and Evstratios Argentis during the Anabaptism issue, and how the decree of 1755 was issued, and how these monks and spiritual persons propagandized and provoked the people in order to attack Patriarch Kalinikos, for example, the patriarch who reject the Anabaptism of Latins. And the third one is the prestige and power and gained by the spiritual leaders, and this game of power between churches and countries. And by saying that, I have in mind the competition on the claim on the Hagia Sophia, the Basilica on Hagia Sophia, during the Allied occupation of Constantinople in 1919. During the occupation, the Allies the Catholic Church engaged in a diplomatic struggle to prevent the Church from being returned to Orthodox worship, because as the apostolic delegate, Angelo Dolci, apostolic delegate of Constantinople, said that this would strengthen the prestige of the ecumenical patriarchate. So this was something that they had to prevent. So we have to keep all this in mind when we speak about these differences between these churches. Of course, we have seen in the history of the relationship of the two churches important steps, efforts of reconciliation. I just remind you the joint lifting of the anathemas on December of 1965, Pope's apology for the fall of Constantinople, the capture and the fall of Constantinople by the Latins. More could be done, such as, for example, the formally abolishing of the Anabaptist degree. This is something that we could do. Mm-hmm. And as history has shown, these are steps, small steps, but are possible steps that we can take in order to approach each other. So by saying that I would like to, I'm not sure if we have any question.
I would like to have
me too.
Something to say.
Okay, I don't see any more Adalberto Mainardi from Bose. I think he left. First, okay, let's give the floor to Dimitrios Keramidas, and then Professor Vasiliadis can close, I think, our today session.
Thank you, Theodosios, for all the others for the valuable comments. So you mentioned the use of the term Latins and Greeks in the Middle Ages. So the Catholic Church does not define anymore. It's Latin Church, not all Catholics are Romans anymore. We have Eastern Catholics belonging to different Eastern families, Byzantines, Maronites, Chaldeans, and so on. So this two are Catholics as well, though this is not to support the universalism of the Catholic Church, but how the Catholic Church transformed all these historical circumstances ecclesiologically. They brought these churches into the Catholic communion. So what we need to do now, and I this is a feedback to what Stamatopoulos said before, so we suffer as Orthodox from nationalism. We have condemned nationalism in the 19th century and again in Crete in 2016, but we have done nothing to overcome this reality, this historical reality that has become a part of our ecclesial identity. What we need now is a theological interpretation, not of nationalism, but of autocephaly. So autocephaly is not to confirm national identities, but all to create the conditions for a church to isolate herself from the others. Of course, this observation goes also for the Ukrainian church. This is not to confirm national identities. What lacks in the Orthodox is to understand, reinterpret, or transform theologically or ecclesiologically a historical circumstance, that of the rise of nationalism. We have not yet reached at this point because the Orthodox were unable to discuss the topic of autocephaly, which was supposed to be brought under this discussion in Crete, but no document was able to be made in order to satisfy all or claims or requests or views on this point. So we have to explain ecclesiologically and theologically the nationalism in terms of autocephaly that exists in a given place but enters into communion with the other churches. So I do not suggest here to copy what the Catholics did in their encounter with different ecclesial identities, but what we haven't done yet as Orthodox. And this is one of the reasons that we face all these recent problems with the creation of Orthodox parallel structures in Orthodox territories. That was a short comment on your reflection. Thank you,
Professor Vasiliadis.
I have just received the apologies of Reverend Dr. Adalberto Mainardi, who has joined the service now and cannot miss, and he has apologized. I'm saying this because he was the only Catholic in the so-called panel. Before I express my sincere gratitude to both to the coordinator, but especially to the main speaker for this enlightening meeting, I would say, I would also like to thank the intervention, the historians who intervened, church historian and historians proper, if I may say so, because they gave us a paramount of the development. And on this point, I would like to add something which was also hinted later, that this kind of initiative on our foundation, on the Center of Ecumenical and Missiological and Environmental Studies, to discuss this kind of very delicate issue of looking forward to the union, to the unity of the Church of Christ, both Eastern and Western. This was motivated by a great initiative undertaken by the present Pope, who has even, I would say, surprised most of us that he went even further than we Orthodox, who are proud of our conciliarity, our synodality against the importance they place to the primacy. Now, a few months ago, they have started on his initiative and proposal, a thorough conciliar process to the extent that he was inviting all the people of God, all the members of his church, not to rely only on his authority, but to take responsibility, because this was the meaning of the witness, which is in the plan of regaining synodality, something that even our churches are not in full form. We have synodality, but only at higher level. He has initiated something that has been a dream for us. And for this reason, this development, historical development, but also theological development, has given us the opportunity to have some more hope that something can be achieved between these two churches, Eastern and Western, Catholic and Orthodox. And of course, we cannot hide anymore the lack or the disagreement between the Orthodox, different Orthodox churches about the importance of primacy. The Catholic Orthodox dialogue was almost halted for, let's say, a decade because of the insistence of the Russian mainly not approving the importance of underlining the primacy, because they have another vision, another ecclesiological vision, geopolitical, I don't like to say more, but they have different, and this is not only Russians who have different ideas about how the church, the unity, or the expression of the oneness of the church can be manifested. And this is something which has been all manifested not only, as I said, before and after the Great and the Holy and Great Council, but also very recently. So we have something which had divided us. We were expressing the faith of the Church of Synodality, the Church of the Tradition, and so on and so forth, while the centralized authority of papacy was accused of being placing only the emphasis on primacy. Now the Catholic Church has trying to reverse this understanding of the church unity, and we Orthodox cannot stay without responding in the same positive way. Once again, I would like to thank you all. I was assigned the task to close the meeting because of the responsibilities of our technical advisor and the so-called deputy director of the program in Orthodox Ecumenical Theology, Professor Nikolaos Dimitriadis. All I am going to ask you, say a good night, a good year again to our listeners. We are closing now, and once we close, the recording will stop immediately. Thank you all again, and especially Dimitrios, Theodosios, and all the other who intervened. Good night to everybody.
Good night.
Thank you. Thank you. Good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Good night. Good night. Bye-bye.
Good night.